Good morning. I'm very pleased to be back here in St. Gallen, 30 years after I have actually graduated here as an economist. And believe it or not, the University of St. Gallen was my first stepping stone in my career as a humanitarian. I attended one of these job fairs at the university when I was listening to a fascinating presentation of two delegates of the International Committee of the Red Cross. And from then onwards, I had a plan. I knew what I wanted to do after I had graduated at the university. I have to admit, however, that my plan, my wonderful plan, didn't extend beyond spending a couple of years with the ICRC. And I also remember very well the words of my father when I announced my decision to work for the International Committee of the Red Cross. "My son," he said, "do that for 2 years, but please, afterwards, get a real job." Now, nearly 30 years on, I'm still here, thoroughly enjoying what I'm doing as Director of Operations of the International Committee of the Red Cross, overseeing our humanitarian response globally in over 90 countries with 18,000 people and a turnaround of every year of nearly 2 billion Swiss francs. I have now spent half of my life in conflict zones, and while our mission and mandate to protect and assist people affected by conflict hasn't changed at all, the way we are going about our work has significantly evolved in the 30 years I've been in the sector. Perhaps most importantly, given the increasingly complex needs that we are confronted with of people affected by conflict, we are increasingly relying on partnerships with all facets of society, social, economic, as well as scientific. And that is why students like many of you here today can make a huge impact. All of us can be humanitarian. We can all be humanitarians. I will use my own experience to tell you why I believe that all of us can be humanitarians. And to that end, I have to go back to the beginning of my career, to my first assignment in Somalia at the beginning of the 1990s. And already at that time, Somalia was a country torn apart by a brutal civil war with several armed factions vying for power. Our ICRC team even had to evacuate, so bad was the security in Somalia, and our team started to operate from neighboring Kenya, from Nairobi. When I arrived, I was actually going to be the first delegate to be posted back in Somalia. The only problem was that nobody told me so. And I was therefore totally unprepared for what followed. Just a few days after my arrival in Mogadishu, the capital of Somalia, my boss pulled out $20,000 of his pocket, handed them over to me, and told me, "You will now wait for a cargo vessel that will berth at the seaport here in Mogadishu with 750 tons of food, and you will distribute this food to the hundreds of thousands of displaced people in Mogadishu." And the same day, my boss, he took a plane back to Nairobi. And I found myself completely alone in the midst of conflict, violence, and growing needs in Mogadishu. I was totally terrified. I was really terrified. Of course, we had discussed about food distributions in our training course in Geneva. But coming from a mountainous country like Switzerland, I had never seen a ship in my whole life. Let alone organize the food distribution in a huge town where needs far exceeded our capacity to assist. And I vividly remember that evening lying in my bed at the hotel, crying, totally desperate, and feeling very, very sorry for myself. It was not so much the shooting and shelling that was going on outside the hotel. It was just that I felt totally abandoned by my boss, by the ICRC, and by the whole world. That night, I seriously considered to quit my job as ICRC delegate. It obviously turned out otherwise. During that same night, my utter desperation first turned into anger and then into a very strong determination that I was now going to show my boss and the ICRC, and probably most importantly to myself, that I could do it. And I actually did it, although I have to say, of course, it is really actually my wonderful Somali colleagues who did it, because, of course, I was not alone. What I didn't recognize at the time was that Somalia, in many ways, was also the harbinger of the changing nature of conflict that has driven many of the changes and the evolution in humanitarian work. What are these changes? I'll just mention a few of them. The first and perhaps most important one is the fact that today's conflict lasts much longer than conflicts 2 decades ago. If I look at our 10 largest operations worldwide, our average presence in these countries is 36 years. 36 years. So therefore, we cannot continue to ignore the fact that people need more than just a food parcel every month. And they really want to rebuild their lives, and we started to support their lives and livelihoods. Second, the rapid urbanization also results in more and more conflicts being fought in densely populated urban areas. I was myself based in Sarajevo during the 90s, and I witnessed firsthand the devastating effect of conflict on urban communities. And the difference between urban and rural communities is that in towns, people are not just directly affected by conflict, like what we've seen in Raqqa, in Mosul, and in Aleppo most recently. They are also affected by indirect consequences, because infrastructure, vital infrastructures such as water, sanitation, health, marketplaces, schools, are destroyed. One more recent example of those cumulative effects of conflict in urban areas is the cholera outbreak in Yemen in 2018. I just happened to be in Sana'a in May 2018 when the first cholera cases started to fill the local hospitals in Yemen's capital. The war that had broken out in Yemen had significantly degraded Yemen's health, water, and sanitation systems. And the moment the rainy season started, cholera spread like wildfire. And the health system was totally incapable to deal with the problem. By the end of 2018, 1.5 million Yemeni were affected by cholera, one-third of them children under 5 years old, and up to 3,000 people had died, according to the World Health Organization. This is a vivid example to show what are some of the consequences of conflict in urban areas. Another trend is that armed groups have not just, the number of armed groups has not just grown, and they have become more radical in the past 2 decades. they have also become increasingly more fragmented. Our own research shows that more armed groups have formed in the past 6 years than the 60 years before. And when I was driving in 2015 from Damascus to Aleppo, we had to travel through almost 60 different checkpoints, most of them belonging to different warring factions. That obviously makes the work that we are doing extremely challenging in these type of contexts. And as you, some of you may know, the International Committee of the Red Cross is not just a relief organization. We are also urging warring parties to comply with international humanitarian law, which is embodied primarily in the Geneva Conventions. What is the basic idea of international humanitarian law? The basic idea is that civilians, prisoners of war, and wounded and sick should be protected during times of conflict. The problem is that these very principles have come under increasing pressure in the past two decades, characterized by the so-called war against terror. The respect for international humanitarian law has come under pressure, not just from radical armed groups, also from states that are increasingly taking exception or lowering the bar when they fight against terrorism. One good example, or actually bad example, I should say, to illustrate what I'm talking about, is the dehumanizing discourse and stigmatization of people in Syria and Iraq that are associated with the Islamic State group. There are hundreds of thousands of people, in their large majority women and children, that are completely stigmatized and cannot reintegrate in society. Now, moving on, a lot of people actually ask me very often, what is your biggest worry as director of operations of the ICRC? My answer is very often that my biggest worry is the growing gap between humanitarian needs on one hand and our capacity as humanitarians to respond to these needs. This is primarily a result of some of the trends that I outlined just here, but also the result of the dramatic spike in armed conflict in the past 10 years. And that is why we cannot afford to stand still and do nothing. We have to find better, new, more effective ways of responding to the challenges that are in front of us. And at the heart of our concern needs to be more sustainable impact for people. In all these years that I've been traveling in situations of armed conflict, I have never met anybody who is happily depending on humanitarian handouts. All people want, in all these contexts I've visited everywhere, is to continue, run their businesses, to send their kids to school, and to fend for their families. That's what people want. And that is why we are increasingly, as I said before, focusing on rebuilding the lives and livelihoods of people affected by armed conflict. And very often, this is happening, this can only happen in partnerships with others, because many of the needs that people have today, we as humanitarian organizations cannot address them alone. For example, in the northeast of Nigeria, we are working with a local foundation run by one of the most important businessman in Nigeria to support displaced women to become entrepreneurs. Or another example, in South Sudan, we are working with the World Bank to improve access to primary and secondary health care for the people of that war-affected country. And last but not least, another example is in the Ukraine, we are working with the Global Fund deliver drugs for non-communicable diseases into the eastern part of the country, into the Donbas, where we are one of the few organizations that has actually access to these areas. There is also need for more innovation in the humanitarian sector. And digital technologies obviously hold a huge potential to revolutionize our work. Looking at big data, for instance, already today, tapping into big data helps us to better understand conflict dynamics and the needs of people and to provide more targeted response, a more targeted response. The widespread use of mobile and smartphones also helps us to connect to people that otherwise are out of reach, as we did, for instance, in Mosul and in Raqqa. And another example is our investment in facial recognition software, which helps us to more efficiently and effectively reconnect people that have been separated by conflict. All of this, again, requires partnerships with the private sector, with the tech sector, as well as with universities. The last example that I would like to mention to you is we are also exploring new financing models that are based on the logic of investment, investing capital and repaying capital. This holds the potential of generating more sustainable impact, but also of pulling in new different actors into fragile and conflict settings. We have, for instance, at the ICRC launched the world's first humanitarian impact bond with the objective to draw new capital into physical rehabilitation projects in Mali, Nigeria, and the Democratic Republic of Congo. And we are, at the same time, as we speak, exploring possibilities to use similar models to improve access to education for children in South Sudan and extending the water network in Goma, which is the most important town in the Eastern Democratic Republic of Congo. The case that I want to make today is that the business of assisting and protecting people as affected by conflict should not be left to humanitarians alone. Collaboration is a very critical aspect of preparing ourselves for future challenges. And humanitarian solutions are better and more effective if we involve affected people from the very start, and if we draw upon the skills and experiences of different sectors of society, be it the public sector, the private sector, civil society, the scientific sector, and more practice-oriented organizations. It is therefore more important than ever to harness the positive forces in our societies, because it is only through partnerships we will manage to address the growing humanitarian needs. Thank you very much.